Thank you, Marcela. It's hard for me to know how should I speak? I know I have mainly. Fixing that, I would just say that it's hard for me to know if I should do it in English or in Spanish. I know that we have a mainly Spanish-speaking audience here, but I also know that we have people who know mostly in English, and I have to say, many emotional, very emotional things, and I think that it will be helpful for me to do. And, well, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, but it's not here. It's not going to be a lecture at all. This is going to be a conversation. We're going to chat a little bit. And I'm completely open for you, probably while I'm talking. I think that way it would be much more comfortable for me. My plan was completely different before today started. I had planned something absolutely different. But when I woke up today, I realized it was not a very regular day in my life. I'm very sure that the most personal should be the most universal. If you want to talk to someone, talk about yourself, because they will somehow see themselves in you, always. I hadn't realized that until I woke up today. And I said to myself, you're going to talk about opera. Empathy, how it's helpful to build community, to make you happy. And mother, opera, lapses. I was going to say mother came to me through opera, instead of saying opera came to me through my mother. Maybe the first way was going to stand. Opera came to me. It took me a long time to realize exactly how and why. I just remembered my mother loving opera, and trying to make me familiar with it, and I hate opera to death. I will explain a bit later. But when I was about 30, not about, I was 30 years old, year 2000, I was writing my first novel. The title of my first novel is Thou Shall Not Honor Thy Father. Let me try to keep this here. Okay. It's to an opera, Madama Butterfly. And it was like a thunderbolt. In a matter of life, a major issue about my life. And it was through opera. Remembered myself as a very small boy next to my mother. I hadn't understood why she always made me listen to that opera next to her. It's not so nice when I'm going to say, as you may expect. And then I realized why it was Madama Butterfly.
Oscar.
Could we have the first video? Asian who's in love with an American Marine. She gets pregnant from him. And he goes away. This is an opera that tells the story of a single mother. That's why it is so powerful. That's why it is eternal. Single mothers are frequent and eternal story. Almost everywhere. So she's a geisha. She's in love with this American guy. Comes from a distant country, from a distant culture. She keeps having faith in his return. She's positive sure he will return. She's also a very, I don't know how to say it, this in community. And she has a small boy. And she keeps telling him, she keeps telling him about his father. She keeps telling him he'll come back in a ship which is called Abraham Lincoln. Keep that name in your mind. Abraham Lincoln is the name of the boat where in which his father comes back, but not to be with his mother. My mother was a Catholic. And an actress. And my father was Jewish, from a distant culture. And my mother kept not telling me he was going to come back, but telling me nice things about him and his country and his culture. When I was in that room in a hotel writing my novel, I just couldn't believe it. My mother put the opera to me because she was telling me my story, because she wanted me to remember it, to know the story. When I was old enough to understand what it meant. So now you might realize how opera became so important to me before I even knew it. And now let's have the first video of Shosan. My mother is has the fantasy about him coming back. Let's listen. Arriving to the port from the end of the world. It's a daydream. She's imagining that day, the moment he comes back. How will he approach to me? me nice things and call me my little beloved one. Very moving, very intense, very touching. And I listened to it, I can't even imagine how many times when I was 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, it was about myself. It was my story being told through opera. Okay. I said I hated opera. True, was it because I was the musical Jewish genes from my father? I didn't know that. My mother did know. I learned to read music before I learned to read words and letters. And before I was 4. And I was very good, really good. So why? That it was spoiled by people screaming things I could not understand. That was my first approach to opera. Let me just see what I wrote as a guy. And I kept that way until I was about 13. My mother was at the theater, maybe rehearsing. I'm not sure, but some sorts of great. But I was alone. I was by myself. And then when nobody noticed, I just at home. My mother loved opera, of course. And I said, well, now nobody's listening to me. Nobody will know. I'm just giving it a try. Get the virus, the opera virus, it will stay. Now it's we all the time talk about viruses, but that's the strongest you can get. It is incurable. It will not kill you. You will not die with it, but you will certainly die for it. It is something very, very. But then I thought, and I'm thinking of what made me love so much opera. And I realized it has to do with fiction. Fiction is one of my favorite, not past tense, it's part of theater and music. All my passions were blended and opera then became part of my life. Another one of my favorite fiction or fictional pastimes. decided to do it about fiction and how fiction had played a major role in my life. The name of the title for the TED Talk was Once Upon a Time, and we very frequently think that opera or that fiction is something that distracts you from reality, things that are not real, and that you are, as we say in Spanish, te fugas with that, and are not in the present with the people. And I realize it is, I know, I'm sure, to the contrary. Fiction is the best way to be here, and to be now, and to be in the here and in the now. Why? Because with fiction, you are with so many people that you are real. Fiction is a way, it's one of the best schools to work out your feelings. With other people to learn how to do and give that step. But most of all, it is a crucial tool for empathy. And empathy being learning to be in the place of others, to feel what other feels. In fact, it comes from other, sorry, to feel the other one's crucial for our life. So, fiction helped me, and opera was. Why is opera the summit of fiction? I have to add a couple of things. I studied piano at the conservatoire. I did get my degree in biochemistry. Piano and biochemistry. Yeah, that's hard to explain. And not so hard. I will tell you why I'm saying this about biochemistry. Because it means it led me to passion for science, for the human body, and mostly for the brain. I'm in love with the brain, with our brain, how it works, and how it is related everything we do with a fictional tool for manifestation, because it adds to fiction the power and the magic of the human voice. And special. And singing is something quite special. And I'm not sure we are all that familiar with the idea, and you know why. Have you ever thought about this? Everyone sings. Everyone here sings. Sings. Everyone has ever sung in human history. Everywhere. Might be in a polluted, overcrowded city, or in a virginal, isolated population. Sing. Have you ever thought, why do we sing? It's interesting. I've done this exercise many times with many people, as Marcela, the Mexican consul, was telling you, with jails, men, women, teenagers. And I asked them that question. We now know that our brain is wired to be receptive, extra receptive to the human voice. It's a species. It has proven to be evolutionary help crucial. And the human voice or singing is the most elaborate, powerful, and emotional. So if we add asking us to work out our feelings to other people, to become other people. And if you add to that music, which is so powerful, human voice, which is incredibly powerful, and singing, which is thermonuclear power in terms of emotion. Confused about what I wanted to do, which is very clear by saying I studied piano and biochemistry. But I knew I wanted to tell stories. I love to tell stories. That's the real thing I really love to do. And I started to write since I was very small, to write about other people, other countries, other characters. Everything I had to do about me was I was writing myself. So I became a writer. Opera also helped me path, not a path, type of English. Let me say something, some words in Spanish. La opera, I want to rest a little bit. La opera, la opera, yeah, because I'm trying to say, this is, I mean, if I were saying things about opera, telling you Verdi's life or Puccini's life, it's like automatic, you know? So, la opera me ayudó a encontrar un terreno en el que todo se anulaba. Mi amor por la ficción, mi amor por contar historias y porque me contaran historias. Mi madre no estaba presente, yo ahí no tenía la menor idea de la historia que les acabo de contar o que les estoy contando. Entonces me pareció lógico empezar a tratar. I can switch to English. Mm-hmm. And then I started to write about opera, and I thought that doing critique was a good idea. I don't like that anymore, but I did many years. I wrote music critique with a professional musical background. I loved opera. I knew a lot about opera, yes, I did. I studied it. Listen, thousands and thousands of hours of opera. So I started to write in the newspapers and it went well. People liked the way I was able to attend the Salzburg Festival, and then without knowing there was a music prize at the Salzburg Festival, I won it without knowing it. Because every critic who wrote about the festival just won the contest. And then, in that moment, Mexico's Minister of Culture, the equivalent of the Minister of Culture, Rafael Tovar de Teresa, who's not anymore with us, realized it might be a good idea. This very, very young Mexican guy who just worked for the opera in Mexico would be a good idea. So that's why at 27, 28, I won the prize in Salzburg and became Mexico's National Opera House director, which was heaven and hell. But it's like going into the wilderness. It's really, really so many egos, so many divas, so many intense people involved, and you being the director, and everyone was old enough to be my father, my mother, my grandfather. So it was very hard. But then DOS built a community. Because as Marcela told you, I was able to do like 350 opera performances. And I got really acquainted with the audience that was always family means love, means quarrels, means all the most beautiful and the less beautiful things of the human beings. That's the family, the one that opera builds around itself. And I also realize how they got very old, and when someone was not attending the opera, it was like, where is that guy that usually comes, where is he? So it was very, very interesting. And but my attitude towards teaching or talking, fue un momento en el que empecé a tratar de comunicar o de acercar la ópera a otras personas. Como todo joven que había llegado a tener un puesto más o menos importante muy pronto, yo era una colección de ego, arrogancia, soberbia, total. Consideraba que en el que solo podían estar los más cultos como yo, los que hablan idiomas como yo, todo era desde ahí, y era la idea de, a ver, esta gente que no sabe de ópera, que no ama la ópera, pobrecitos, hay que ver si uno los puede llevar de la mano, pobres seres inferiores, hay que tratar de acercarlos hasta este mundo maravilloso que es la ópera. Poco a poco me di cuenta de que estaba totalmente equivocado, de que esa era la manera exactamente incorrecta de acercar la ópera a la gente. 22 y 23 años para entender que la vida podía ser de otra manera, y que para comunicarle algo a alguien de verdad lo tienes que hacer desde otro lugar. So, having said this in Spanish, after I realized opera was completely arrogant, I tried to switch to another style. First, it was like a style, like, you know, I have to become another character. I have to develop a new character in order to teach opera, a more appealing one. That I was really wrong. That opera is not that fancy. That opera is not difficult or elitist. You say elitist, we for the elite. Mm-hmm. The opera has to do with real life. Has to do with, not always with ordinary people, because normal people, regular people, or ordinary people. But it has to do with ordinary, normal, human emotions, feelings. And that opera was really that. So I acercar la ópera a la gente era mostrarles lo siguiente. En vez de tratar de convencer a la gente, instead of trying to convince people they needed to love opera, I realized it. And it worked. It worked incredibly well. And then I decided to start a project called Hablemos de Opera. This was a few years ago. Out of necessity, I must say. I needed it. And I started, and then the pandemic started, and it made me do something I didn't want to do, which is to go to the internet to start doing my all my project through Facebook, through Zoom, and then a miracle happened. thankful to the pandemic. That would be stupid to say. But I was not expecting. When I started, when the pandemic started, we had a project like between Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Said all this, I return to the title of this conversation, which is opera as a means to build community and foster happiness. I will switch to Spanish for a while. Hace inductora de felicidad. La ópera produce felicidad. Al final de la conferencia se acercó alguien y me dijo: usted dijo que la ópera produce felicidad, y lo dijo con mucha seguridad. Yo estoy organizando un congreso de ciencias de la felicidad. La produce felicidad, porque lo dijo con mucha seguridad. So I accepted to go to give a lecture to a congress for sciences of happiness, or however you call them, in order to prove that opera does produce happiness. Chemist in me and my help. And here's where I can somehow link everything I've said. Opera is fiction. And science has proven fiction fosters empathy. I've already tried to explain what empathy is, but what happens in our brain when we feel empathy? We can measure it. We can take our brain is a neurotransmitter cocktail. We always have different neurotransmitters on our brain. And I've never said these names in English. Dopamine, all these things which make our mood. Our mood is a combination of those. You don't have serotonin, you're depressed. You are in a rush, you have an excess of dopamine. The mother, and then they put the baby next to you. A few seconds after he was born, you are sweating prolactin. Or here, which helps you bond. Serotonin, tenderness. Oxytocin, trust. Dopamine, energy, aggressiveness. Feelings of tenderness. All makes sense. So when you're feeling empathy, you have a nice quantity of serotonin. You have to feel sweet, amoroso. You have to have a lot of oxytocin. You have to trust and to make yourself trustworthy. So, fiction does that. Opera does that. It is able to make you happy. Something much more important. When you are feeling empathy, You cannot do it. It's impossible. Your brain is not in the mindset to be aggressive, to being aggressive. You cannot do it. We live in a world in which we have criminal acts, people hurting physically. Feeling empathy, you cannot foster emotion, fosters behaviors which are non-criminal. That's a fact. That's not wishful thinking. That's not just a phrase to sound really opera appeal. If opera is the most intense fictional or one of the most intense fictional activities. Can you imagine foster happiness but to diminish criminal acts? Therefore, I think we should all make people, our friends, our children, our relatives, listen to opera. No. Strange things, and all those things have to do with this kind of positive behaviors. Por eso me di cuenta de que llevar a las cárceles y poner en las cárceles ópera producía cosas increíbles. Tuve la oportunidad de estar en una cárcel de darles una charla sobre ópera solamente a mujeres miembros de bandas de secuestradores, y es una de las experiencias más impresionantes de mi vida. Dos de ellas tenían a sus bebés en la cárcel. Yo no sabía que las mujeres podían tener a sus bebés en la cárcel, y estaba con un grupo de mujeres que habían cometido esos actos terribles con sus bebés. Opera is not only politically correct, it can be very helpful for countries. I'm here to give a workshop for the LA Opera and now Los Angeles. I'm here thanks to Mexico, which is one of the most incredible universities in the world and one of real things my country, Mexico, has done well in its history. It starts with students, and they are all so receptive to opera. Mi apoyo a la ópera tiene que ver más ya con esto, the beginning. I would like to finish where I started. You remember, I was telling you about Madame Butterfly. Fly. You won't believe this. This can only be done by opera. You remember I told you about the boat for Pinkerton, the Marine Returns. You remember the name? In a very different ways, away from many operas, my personal story has a beautiful ending, incredible ending. No, I never met my father. I met my siblings, my two brothers, and my sister, my father's Jew, a Jewish, my father's Jewish Jew. And 20 years ago, we started a beautiful relationship. Today, we became brothers, real brothers. Each other all the time, but most of all, they have become what they really are. Because love each other. Would you like to know? Take a guess. What? I met my brothers, my siblings, you say, my brothers. Take a guess. What was the name of the project?
Lincoln.
So I would like to finish with the moment Madame Butterfly watches the and realizes the name is Abraham Lincoln. Or should I say, I would like to end with the way I see myself. I would say this in English to finish. Me gustaría terminar entonces con este momento. Un momento en el que se confunden, como debe ser. Yo nunca he entendido ni estoy dispuesto a entender la frontera entre la ficción y la realidad. Me parece que distinguir la frontera entre la ficción y la realidad no quiere decir vivir confundido, que esa realidad, que esa frontera es permeable. Bueno, Estados Unidos y México es una frontera por la que se puede pasar mucho más fácilmente de lo que uno piensa. Si esto es políticamente incorrecto, lo lamento, pero me viene a la mente en este momento. Estoy en la segunda ciudad con más mexicanos del mundo. Darme cuenta de que el parque se llamaba Abraham Lincoln fue un shock terrible. Yo acababa de conocer a mis hermanos 2 meses antes en el parque Abraham Lincoln. Y estaba yo que el parque se llama de esa manera. En ese instante entendí todo. En un segundo entendí, en un fragmento de segundo pasó toda mi vida. En ese instante me vi a mí mismo, literalmente como un niño sentado junto a mi madre, y mi madre como si hubiera enviado un, como cuando uno pone un mensaje en una botella y la avienta en el mar, pero el mar era el tiempo. Y de pronto, tantos años después, esa botella llegó a mí y llegó en un mar que se iba a fundir de la mejor manera posible la realidad. La ópera sirve para, a través de la empatía, generar comunidad, generar felicidad. La ópera sirve, realmente seguro de que sirve para todos nosotros. La ópera ya está en nosotros. Todos, o sea, todo el mundo. A ver, ¿cuál es uno de mis apodos? Yo mismo me lo puse, entonces lo puedo decir. Exagerado. La ópera es exagerada, pero todos tenemos esa parte, todos somos exagerados, algunos no nos dejamos serlo, otros nos dejamos serlo más. La ópera, las buenas y las malas, somos Otelo muerto de celos y somos Iago traicionando y somos Madame Butterfly esperando, fantaseando de lo que amamos, y somos Mimi y Rodolfo enamorados como lo que son, unos adolescentes con una relación tremenda entre padre e hijo, y somos Electra y Orestes y Egisto en una relación de padre. O sea, cualquier emoción humana, la que me digan, podemos jugar, díganme una emoción humana, díganme un... La ópera está ahí, la ópera somos todos, la ópera son terminemos escuchando Chin y después de oír y ver una rambling con a todos los que lo busquemos. Así es que denle la oportunidad. Gracias. No sé si alguien quiere comentar algo, No sé si se acostumbra. Sí, por favor.
I have a question.
Not anymore. In as many languages in you as you can imagine, there are operas in Spanish, there are operas in every language. Of course, opera is a genre invented by Italians. Before Italy existed as a country, like in 1580, 1590, in 80 years, and the first country where it moved to was France. Then from France, it also went to the German countries or the German-speaking countries, but it also started to migrate towards Spain, England, and then by the artistic manifestation, which is written in almost every language.
And the second question is, I've seen difference between that I've said and the being saint with orchestra in the back, like, you know, the famous Pavarotti concerts.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Is that the same opera?
No, we wouldn't call it opera because opera has to be
stage.
It's opera excerpts or an opera gala, or sometimes it is done as an opera in concert. For instance, for any reason, you don't have enough money or whatever for the production, for the sets, for the costumes, then you just do it, as we say, in concert, and there's an extra stage and not stage.
Thank you.
¿Alguien más que quiera comentar algo, preguntar algo? ¿Estamos? Sí, por favor.
You made a comment about the arrogance and elitism in opera, broader audience. What is your current observation of the opera community in general, and also even the orchestras, the arts? There is communities of that type of elitism. Do you see that same breakthrough happening in general terms as the community itself that you found?
I do see it. Because, and it also has to do with a practical reason. You cannot keep it because it's not the... And nowadays, just imagine. Nowadays, it's even more difficult for older people to attend performances. And it will be people will feel less safe. I'm just thinking about this approach or win new public by having the same old strategies. They are addressing in a different way. They can do much more. That's right. They can do much more. And they need to do much more. They need to use, in a better way, social media, I think. And they need make an extra effort to sound audiences. I think the attitude has changed, but not the outcome yet. That's true.
Were you early on in that realization, or meaning were you one of the first, or were they already experts?
It would be arrogant for me to say that it was me who started this. Yeah. But I think, no. But I must tell the truth, I must tell you the truth. I think that when I realized that country in Mexico were thinking about opera that way, because I was part of the opera elite. Well, unbearable people, really, really. since they've seen the project is working very well, now since they sell somehow, which is the same. And but I want to stay with one word, which I love. Elitism, you say that was elitism. When people ask me about opera being or not elitistic or elitist, because I say, yes, of course, it is. And then say, come on, it's